Georgia Fortunato.
I'm Bethany.
I'm Kristen.
I'm Tracy.
I'm Rita.
I'm Miriam.
I'm Carrie.
I'm Ian.
Maria Mesa.
Kim Hamilton.
Laura Hirsch.
Megan Graham.
Grace Diaz.
Lee Gaspar.
Shilpanen.
Zalda Collins.
Donna Pregone.
Amanda Simoneau.
Mary Reynolds.
Sue Turcotte.
Brenda Beauregard. This is my partner.
Kristina Michelena.
Jennifer Vecchio.
I am Miriam Shalcross Smith.
And I am Amy Shalcross Vogel. And we're mother and daughter in business.
I am woman. Hear me roar in numbers too big to ignore.
Hello there, and welcome to Women's Business. My name is Dr. Marianne Shalcross-Smith, known to most as Dr. Daycare. I would like to welcome you to a mentoring program designed to educate our community on issues facing working women. We'll be speaking to our guests in the areas of arts, science, education, law, marketing, medicine, politics, retail, military, and of course, women's business. The goal of the show is to provide information that comes only from the personal experience of our guest and to pass that information down to our daughters, nieces, neighbors, friends, and family. Much of the content will relate to the guest speaker's journey in their profession, what they learned most about the process, and what they wish they knew before they began the process. Since women-owned business is the fastest-growing sector in our economy, our guests will close with a lesson learned she'd like to pass on to the viewing audience. And I would like to say thank you very much for viewing. Today our guest is Diana Imonde Diaz. And come to find out, Diana and I go back to age 8 years old.
Yes, we were neighbors.
Yeah, we were neighbors, and you went to preschool.
Yes.
At Highland Nursery.
Yes.
Karen Anati, who's a very dear friend of me, Dr. Anati. And then you went on to sales school with Keith. And
right.
My goodness, I didn't make all those connections till a little while ago. Oh, that's so cool.
It's one of the greatest things about our state.
Oh,
we,
don't you love
we
Rhode all, Island?
We find each other eventually again.
So. It does. Rhode Island's just such a wonderful, close-knit state. I always say to people, we start talking long enough, we will be related.
Yes,
you know
absolutely.
That, you know. So you're from AAA, and you a bounty of little things going on here from car seat safety, bike safety. Then we're going to talk about the three D's of driving.
Yes.
But why don't we first of all talk about car seats?
Sure.
Tell us a little bit about what's bounties going on here.
Yes, we are actually trying to round up all the unsafe seats out in the community.
Okay.
And you know, with baby products, we like to pass things along to family and friends. It's very common, high chairs and toys and things like that. But car seats actually do expire.
They do,
and most people don't realize that. Most car seats have a 6-year expiration.
Wow.
Some go to 10 years for seats like Britax, some of the higher end car seats like that. But yeah, the technology changes, especially here in New England, where, you know, if a car seat is sitting in a car in the cold winter months and, you know, then in the extreme heat, all those plastics and foams start to actually break down. And they're not as safe. So we say, get them out. And AAA Northeast will be offering a $5 bounty for each car seat turned in between September 8th. Actually, my poster says September 7th, but that's actually Labor Day. I messed up on that.
That's okay.
So, September 8th and 19th. So any AAA branch in the area, any AAA Northeast branch, bring them on in. We just ask that you remove the fabric cover to make recycling easier. We will be recycling. We want to dispose of these responsibly. And you'll get $5. Or if you're feeling charitable, you can donate that $5 to Safe Kids Rhode Island. And those proceeds will go to purchasing car seats for children in need. And I can say I actually work with Safe Kids. I'm the vice president of the board with Safe Kids Rhode Island.
I've never heard of Safe Kids Rhode Island.
Yeah,
what is it? Is it a nonprofit, I'm assuming?
It's a coalition. It's an offshoot right now of Rhode Island Hospital at the Injury Prevention Center.
Yep.
Wonderful coordinators there that we work with. And we check car seats for free as a free service. And we also do a lot of outreach with bike safety, pedestrian and safety for children, just trying to educate the community on ways to keep children safe, especially now in the summer months. Heat stroke has been a big topic too that we try to educate.
So a lot going on about heat stroke. I mean, even pets, and there's a law I guess passed 2 years ago in the General Assembly, even animals in the car.
Yes.
And God, I wish we worried so much about children, because I don't think there's any laws for that.
I know.
However, a big education marketing on television. Mm-hmm. Do not leave your children alone. I know the police officer gets in, so how fast the body temperature goes up.
Yes.
I think it's absolutely wonderful.
There's been 15
put some focus on that.
Child deaths this summer related to heat stroke. Fortunately, not in our state, but we see a lot in, you know, Texas and those warmer climates. But, you know, these are parents, I absolutely don't believe that they realize they're doing. A lot of times they just don't want to wake the child up from a nap and take them into the house. They figure let them sleep, and it takes 15 minutes.
I think the education has been absolutely phenomenal on television. I mean, I hate to say when I was a kid because it was so long ago, but my mom would run into the Eden Hope and leave us a couple of siblings, not even thinking, with the windows down.
Right.
It was like not any education. So I tell you, it's very much out there making people aware.
Yeah.
Certainly no one would do purposely, that's for sure.
Right. But yeah, the car seat safety programs, I think Rhode Island, across the board, we've done a great job with
this because
most police departments, certified technician that can check your car seat for free as well. At AAA, we've tried to make this really convenient for people. We've partnered with Tire Pros as well, and there's a certified technician at all of their shops. And you can visit AAA.com/safe seats and book an appointment. It's really, really convenient. So, you know, where about 78% of car seats are installed incorrectly.
That's right.
We just want to, you know, educate parents and fix those problems. It doesn't take more, typically half an hour tops to make sure your child's riding
safely. Are they installed incorrectly because maybe they took them out of their car to clean the car and didn't put them back in right? Or were they right from the box from the store into the seat? Is this too many?
Oftentimes, yes.
Really?
But mostly we actually see harnessing mistakes.
Oh.
Where the harness that restrains the child isn't clipped right, or it's too loose. We see that a lot. Or with infant seats, the angle isn't correct.
Yep.
It's really important to keep children rear facing. Now until 2 years old, the American Academy of Pediatrics recommends 2 years old. And a lot of moms and dads want to see their child.
They do.
And they turn them prematurely. They turn them around. But, you know, and you'll hear a lot of parents say, well, I feel like they're so uncomfortable. Their legs are getting long and they're pushing up against the back of the seat. One of the pediatricians that I work with always says it's so much easier to fix a sprained ankle or even a broken leg than neck and spinal cord damage. But we kids are so flexible.
We don't
really see injuries from leg injuries and crashes very often.
No.
So
well, it's interesting. I had a group of women at my high school friends at my summer house. And two of the grandmothers had car seats.
Yep.
And one grandma, my friend Val, goes, we had to go all to the beach together. And she's like, I am not moving that car seat. That car seat does not move. You're going to have to take another car to the beach because guess what? That car seat has to be safe. I'm like, you know, Val, I respect you on that.
Absolutely.
You know? So it's like, so the message is getting out there. It really is.
And there's so many great grandparents out there, wonderful grandparents that are such a part of the upbringing of these little ones. And I give them a lot of credit because we do see many, many grandparents come into our checkpoints.
Really?
Just to make sure everything's installed properly.
So it's like a status to have like a car seat and a grandparent's car. I got a grandchild.
Yes.
I got grandchildren. It's so wonderful. You know?
Yes, it's wonderful.
That's good to know they're coming to have their car seats checked.
Yes, it is wonderful. Cool. So.
And now let's talk a little bit about bike safety.
Sure.
Yeah, these helmets, I'm sure, right?
Oh, yes.
I was a generation grew up without no helmets.
Me too.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not long ago.
Yeah, even in my generation, we didn't see it. I remember when my son was about 5 years old, I would say. And we went for our annual visit with his pediatrician. And he asked the wonderful question of, does he have a bike helmet? And at the time, I think he was still on training wheels. And I said, oh my goodness, no. And just within that year, I started my job with AAA as the traffic safety education specialist. And I learned how very, very important helmets are, even for the little ones. And I didn't even realize there is a law in our state saying that children must wear a helmet until they're 15. And I mean, there really shouldn't be a cutoff age. Helmets are for everyone.
Yes, for adults,
certainly.
Too. Yes.
But I get in there at the schools often with children and go over the basics of cycling safety, you know, that they are actually driving their bike. I know we say riding a bike, but they're really, you know, operating on the roadway, just like a vehicle. A lot of cyclists don't realize that they need to, you know, stop at stop signs, stop at lights, and use the same traffic systems as motorists. So I think the Bike Path Network here in Rhode Island is a really exciting thing.
Yes.
And I think, you know, going out for a nice family bike ride with the kids is, I mean, it's great for your health. It's great just to take in the beauty of the state, get some physical activity in. But, you know, at a certain point in time, children start riding on the roadway and they need to know those hand signals. Yeah. And they need to know that, you know, when you are on wheels, your helmet needs to be on, and we help them fit the helmet properly. Learn those techniques to make sure it's a well-fitting helmet.
So how do you know how to fit a helmet on a child?
Well, I use a couple little tricks. Right, that's true too.
Stop there.
Yeah, oftentimes you'll see them kind of throw it on and it's sitting too far back on their head.
Yep.
So I tell them to do what I call an eyebrow check. And take two fingers, the bottom finger should be on your eyebrows, and that top finger should be touching the helmet to make sure it comes nice. Down low enough. And then I tell them, make sure you have peace signs around your ears. So we want to see one strap in front of their ear, one strap behind, where they're not loose, and that keeps the helmet nice and level. And then no more than one finger should fit under their chin.
Oh, wow. So I could just do this.
Yeah, those are easy little tricks that they can remember.
Great little tips to have. Absolutely. And you can remember those. Absolutely.
Right. And then the other thing is visibility. Mm-hmm. And even in my neighborhood, I live in Smithfield, in a neighborhood without streetlights. And I see even my adult neighbors oftentimes cycling or walking their dogs, for example, and wearing really dark clothing. And it's kind of become, you know, my little pet peeve, because so often you don't see, especially pedestrians, until you're right on top of them. And so, you know, we talk about retroflective materials and things like that. I'm a big fan of the L.L. Bean backpacks because they have that nice little triangle with retroflective material on the back, or sneakers, or even jackets.
I think that also goes for a typical walking your dog at night.
Absolutely.
You know, now the days are starting to get shorter.
Yes.
It's going to get darker. By this time next month, it'll probably by 7 o'clock, it'll be dark.
I
think it's wonderful for the exercise that people get out and walk their dogs. That's so important. But I totally agree that you need something on your sneakers or your back
definitely.
So people can see you.
I mean, I'm sort of a traffic safety geek.
I like that. So that's a good geek to be. Right?
I have a cap that's retroflective. I have a retroflective leash for my dog and a little blinky light on his collar. And, you know, if my neighbors think I'm a geek, that's okay, because I'm a safe geek.
That's a very good geek to be. Safe geek's a good one. Now, where can you purchase these things with all the books?
Actually, I've gotten everything I own online.
Okay, got it.
But like I said, huge fan of L.L. Bean because they make things available.
Okay.
Right.
Super. I'll keep that in mind when I buy my grandkids things to really make sure those pieces are on there. That's good to know.
Right.
Yeah. And a dog leash, too.
Yes.
I didn't know they had such things.
Strip right down the middle of the leash. That's retroflective material. So
now, how about families, which I got to give our governor credit. Whenever you see her on Facebook, her and a family go bike riding, bicycle, and they all have their helmets on. I think that's
a great message.
It's a great message, a great model. But is there any pros and cons about families or groups of children cycling on the side of some streets?
I think
you're better off on the bike path. What do you think?
I think you're better off on the bike path.
Okay.
I really do.
Right.
And absolutely, cyclists have a right to the road. We always say share the road, and they have a right to be there. And you know, with our infrastructure changing a little bit, more roadways are built with bike lanes, which is a great thing. I think there's still a little bit of confusion on the part of motorists on whether they're allowed to ride in the bike lane, if they're not, if it's a shared lane, or in there's so many.
It gets confusing.
It does
get
confusing.
It really does. I've always been to, it's been a long time since I've taken driver's ed, but I've always had to respect anyone on a bike, you respect them first.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
I try and move over, but I often worry about when you see 4, 5, 6 kids or families together on sides of the road, there's a lot of traffic.
Right.
Especially there's more and more traffic on the road every single day.
Exactly. And on some, you know, busier roadways, you have to be very mindful of riding single file. Riding with young children, that can be tough sometimes, but I think it's great if there's two adults and one adult in the back, one adult in the front, children in the middle. I have a good friend named Barry Freeman who is with Bike Newport. And she has done an extraordinary job on educating, especially within Aquidneck Island area of our state, families as far as riding. She does a lot of school programs. And she came out with something very clever called the Wave. And if you're driving through, you know, Middletown, Portsmouth, Newport, you'll start seeing signs. It says, "We do the wave." And it just tries to reinforce communication between motorists and cyclists and make those motions. Try to make eye contact with each other and wave them across the road and let them know that you do see them and acknowledge them. Fantastic. It's something so simple.
Wow.
But
it does, it helps.
Makes a difference.
All those pieces of communication really just adds to the safety of families, anyone cycling, because it's a fantastic way to exercise.
It is.
A fantastic way to get the family together.
Right.
Everybody loves bicycling.
Cycling is definitely gained in popularity in the last 10 years, incredibly. At AAA Northeast, we have a group of educators that teach a driver improvement program.
Yeah.
Nice benefit, I have to say, for anyone over 55 or 55 plus, because you actually get a discount on your auto insurance for taking this defensive driving class. But we have a segment of the class just dedicated to sharing the road with what we call vulnerable roadway users. And we do try to reinforce those messages to motorists in our classes that, yes, cyclists have the right to be there just like you do. And,
be vigilant
in looking for them.
Yeah, and they need to have more of the road than we do. You know what I'm saying? We need to really have high expectations that they can have the road. Now, my grandson, I have a 16-year-old beautiful grandson, and he just recently took driver's ed.
Yes.
No more 10, 2 o'clock?
No, 9 and 3 now.
I'm like, wow, 8 to 4, what happened? 9 and 3. So he's 10 and 2.
And I'll tell you why.
I just learned this like last month.
Yes.
So it's probably been out there for 5, 10 years. I just, thank God I have a teenager taking driver's ed.
Well, it's funny that you say that, because even with these driver improvement courses, I say for most of us, we haven't had a refresher since we were
16.
In driver ed ourselves.
Exactly.
But the reason for that change is airbags.
Oh.
So if your airbag deploys and your hands are at 10 and 2, that'll break your wrists, because airbags deploy at about 120 miles an hour.
Whoa.
So we want to keep them out of the way of that airbag. But yeah.
So 9 and 3
9
now.
9 and 3 or 8 and 4. And you notice
and
now
4.
That the redesign of the steering wheels sort of encourage you to hold the wheel lower.
Good to know.
Yeah.
Wow.
I just had that conversation with my mom, because she's trying to retrain herself to drive
tell
a little differently.
Tell your mother, maybe we can take the course together.
Yes, I know. It's fun though.
So you talked a little bit about the 3 D's in driving.
Yes.
Let's
well,
hear about those.
One thing that I think, and you say with your grandson being 16, I'm sure he's been lectured many times about the impaired driving, drunk driving. I mean, there are 3 hours within the Rhode Island driver education curriculum dedicated to just impaired driving in that way.
Thank God.
The one area we kind of missed the boat, and it is included in the new curriculum for driver ed, but drowsy driving is
drowsy.
A huge issue.
That's
and
a big one.
It's very much a cultural issue. I think there's a I'll sleep when I'm dead mentality in our culture.
Yeah.
But we see primarily third shift workers and young drivers as the most vulnerable, most at risk for a fall asleep crash.
Really?
And a few years ago, a wonderful coworker, there was a tragedy in her own family. Could have been much worse, but her son had a very serious crash. He fell asleep at the wheel. And it was a Saturday. He had played in a football game for Wheeler that Saturday morning. He was kind of tired all day long because he was a real go-getter of a kid. Excellent student, lots of extracurricular activities. And that's with the young drivers where we see, not the same type of kid as we would worry about with impaired,
right.
You know, drunk driving or things like that, because these are the really good kids trying to keep up with these really
absolutely.
Busy schedules. So her son Alex fell asleep, and she knew when he wasn't home for curfew that something was wrong, and she started trying to call him and he wasn't answering his cell phone.
Oh.
He was turned upside down off 495 for quite a few hours. And after that really scary tragedy, we started doing even more research on the drowsy driving topic. And we had an opportunity to meet with Dr. Saina at Harvard Medical. Harvard Medical School has a whole sleep medicine division. And we learned that 250,000 people fall asleep every day in the U.S.
Every
while driving.
Day?
And that sounds like a crazy number.
Every year.
every day. And I don't mean fall asleep
completely,
but those little micro naps. Yeah, where, you know, you hit the rumble strip and wow, I'm really tired. Yes. I didn't realize I was this tired. But especially for young drivers, this is a big problem because most, you know, teenagers actually really need about 8 or 9 hours of sleep every night. And they're most are getting about 5.5 to 6.
Okay.
So they live sleep deprived. And the cell phones don't make it better, no, believe it or not. They're taking those cell phones right into their bedrooms, into sometimes into their beds with them and late into the night texting and on social media and things like that. So that's the one dangerous D. The other is distracted driving. And we can't get away from that. I mean, technology has come a long way. I think a lot of vehicle manufacturers believe that systems like Bluetooth, speech to text is going to help the situation. But at AAA, our research has actually shown that it doesn't help.
Really?
That hands-free is not risk-free. It's actually the cognitive distraction that's even more dangerous.
Okay.
And sometimes the speech-to-text systems impair us even more because they're not maybe picking up correctly on our speech, and then we're having to go back and correct the message.
Right. Now you're all involved in that instead of eyes on the road.
Right.
I hear you. Wow.
So it's cognitive, it's manual, and it's visual. It's, you know, all three fall into the distracted driving problem.
I got to give AAA credit for I didn't realize. I think a AAA is travel.
Yeah.
Getting my movie ticket.
Right. Mortgages and student loans.
Really? It's
and
like I didn't realize they took all this driving ed and all this information on. This is fantastic for safety.
Thank you. Yeah. We do a lot of research. And
you can tell it's very research-based, and you got the information to really stand by what you're saying. But I think you also should say to the listening audience, it's just not teenagers.
No, absolutely
not. It's across the board. It's all ages.
You couldn't be more right.
And I'm hearing keep the cell phones in the back, not even the back seat anymore, because I guess when you really want it, you could grab it.
Yeah.
Almost like keep it in the trunk type of thing or something, or keep it off.
And what we see is young drivers is there's actually a rush of dopamine where they are feeling, all those pleasure sensors are lighting up in their brain when they hear that tone that they've received a message or a text.
I think for grandmothers too, sometimes.
But I think we grew up where we didn't have to respond immediately to that tone, and they are so.
We had to wait for that phone call, go home and listen to the machine.
A little more patient, right?
Exactly, little.
And they're wired to respond immediately to everything.
Yes, they are. It's a very good point. Wow.
So.
Wow. So what's the best tips we can give everyone? No texting, no phones.
Like, oh, absolutely.
What are you saying?
You really do have to create a different behavior pattern.
Okay.
Right from the get-go. Okay. Right from the first day your child has a permit. The do not disturb mode is a good thing. And like you said, even putting it into the trunk is a good idea. But with parents, the one concept I drive home or I try to drive home is role modeling. If they see their parent texting, talking, and driving, they're going to do the same. They're not going to really believe that it's as dangerous as it is. But, and of course, inexperience comes into play with the younger drivers, but none of us are safe in terms of distracted driving. And I there needs to be a culture shift. There really does, because I don't think anyone in our society in this day and age is comfortable with their driver, you know, being drunk or impaired behind the wheel. And they will say something.
We all get that message.
Right.
Absolutely.
But with the texting and the, you know, looking at your phone, scrolling through emails or the internet while driving, there's not as much of a culture shift to say, no, you're not going to do that while I'm your passenger.
I just want to bring up again a point you just made was the role model.
Yes.
Moms, dads, grandmas, grandfathers, aunts, uncles, who's ever behind that wheel.
Right.
If you have a child in that car, if the minute you do that, you have just set the tone for that child.
Right. And we're really trying where there's actually legislation pending to mandate a parent class. And this has been done in Massachusetts and in Connecticut, and the results have been very positive. A lot of these laws really aren't understood by the parents as well as they should
be.
So this class would mandate that they get that education and they understand the graduated driver licensing laws and restrictions and penalties for their kids before their child's able to get a driver's license.
So before your child's able to get a driver's license, which we know that's pretty hot on the list for parenting and kids. Those teenagers will bring you to they'll walk you, they'll bicycle you to the class.
To the class, right.
That's a really good to get a whole audience of people in there to retrain.
Right.
Fabulous idea. It's amazing the education that's behind all this.
Right. And that final D, you know, the drunk driving, like I said. What's really scary is we're actually seeing a shift where impaired driving by marijuana is going, within the next 5 years, if this trend continues, overtake drunk driving. So we have to be very mindful, and you know, education, because as states are legalizing and decriminalizing marijuana,
exactly,
impaired driving is becoming a big problem in that arena as well.
Wow.
So,
wow.
That's a little bit of what we do at AAA.
That's a whole segment of AAA I didn't really honestly know exists. I'm so happy you reached out for our child carers. You have gone in and done the bike safety with all the kids in camp for the summer.
And they ask great questions,
do
by
they?
The way.
Yeah, I love
great questions. We got into physics. We
really?
Got into seat belts and why they need to be restrained properly. I mean, they ask much more interesting questions, I think, than the adults sometimes. You have great kids.
Yeah, as long as you allow children to ask questions, they will ask the questions. I've learned that. And the great time to really educate the children is during summer when school's out.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Because I know usually they go to school all day, get a great, fantastic curriculum at school. By the time they get to the after-school programs at home, it's 3:34, and their night begins.
Right.
So when school's out, it's a great, great time. Your timing that you contacted me in June was picture perfect. As you know, I put it right through to my marketing department, and they took everything and went with it. And I heard from all the kids and the parents and the teachers. It was a great program, and so
thank
I appreciate
you.
That. I really do.
And you have great teachers,
don't I?
You do.
I'm the luckiest woman in the world to have the organization that I have with the teachers, the directors, staff, administrators. It's like sometimes I wake up and say, is this like real, you know?
Yeah. You walk in and you know they care, and
it's amazing.
They're so engaged.
It's totally amazing. It really is. I'll take that.
Yay.
Anything, we have probably a minute left. Anything you want to share about how you got here?
I mean,
in your career.
In my career, it's a melding of my background in public relations and in education. And they just came together in my position, which is situated within the Public Affairs Department at AAA. They're at headquarters in Providence. But I get to go out into the community and teach people of all ages now. So I really love my job.
I can tell.
And I actually go back to school starting my master's today.
Oh, my goodness.
So
where
I've been continuing Roger Williams for
college.
Public administration.
Public administration.
I think the learning never stops.
And it doesn't run.
I think the more I've been teaching, the more I want to learn.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Actually, my story there is Lincoln High School. Mm-hmm. 10 years later, started CCRI in Lincoln. Fantastic school. Went from that day forward, thanks for the support of my kids and my husband, to a doctorate degree in my 40s.
Amazing.
So, really,
that's amazing.
You can just keep doing it any age.
Absolutely.
You just got to have it in your heart and want to do it. So that's fantastic.
Right. Thank you.
My goodness gracious. I know a master's degree. That's public administration is a fantastic degree to get. My friends and colleagues who have it said it's an amazing.
Really interesting.
Very interesting. Very, very interesting. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Truly, any lesson you want to pass on to the listening audience?
Stay in school. Never stop learning. And really stay safe on our roadways, because we are sharing our roads with mothers, sisters, children. So stay safe, everyone. Buckle up.
Buckle up.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.